Without further ado, it's my pleasure and privilege to introduce a wonderful man who's going to receive the Lifetime Achievement Award from the Urban Land Institute next week. Very distinguished gentleman, Ray Ritchey.
Thank you, Bill. Well, thank you all. What Bill forgot to point out about the Lifetime Achievement Award is the last two winners, one is dead and one's retired. So I'm not sure what that means relative to my future in real estate. But, you know, I am so honored to be here tonight with the future leaders of the real estate community in Washington, D.C. and throughout the world, literally. And so it's my great privilege to talk to you, give you a little insight about my 37 years in real estate in Washington, D.C. You know, when Bill called me up and said, we want you to come in and talk and give a class for hour and a half, I said, you know, I don't do classes for an hour and a half. I can do panel discussions. So this is going to be what I always wanted to do is a panel discussion where I ask myself my own questions. So we'll be doing a little bit of that. And I also want you all to be panelists as well. So I'll be asking you questions throughout the evening as we go through this, is that what I call the idle ramblings of Washington, D.C. real estate. And I also, want you to be actively involved. And I have a few ground rules for tonight. First of all, what is said in Georgetown stays in Georgetown. I don't want you going back to Folger Pratt tomorrow and said, Ritchey said that Folger Pratt's project in Rockville was really difficult. So let's keep the information here. Anything I say, don't come back to me 6 months from now and said, Ray, you said the percentages of returns were such and so. Nothing really factual. Again, this is not a one-hour monologue. This is very much a discussion with everyone here in the room. And lastly, I'm waiving the two-drink minimum that Georgetown normally imposes on his classes. So the first question, and again, guys, there's no such thing as free lunch. There'll be a little bit of commercialism relative to Boston Properties as we go through this. So the first question from some complete random in your audience said, I've heard so many wonderful things about Boston Properties. Can you give us a quick overview of the company and your portfolio relative to real estate development? So we were founded in 1970 by Mort Zuckerman. Many of you may know Mort has got interests other than just real estate. He was a professor at Harvard. He owns the Daily News in New York. He owns U.S. News and World Report. Mort will be the first to say he makes his money in real estate and loses in publishing. Over the past 40-some years, we have developed over 40 million square feet, and we have 15 million square feet in the pipeline. We have 5 regional offices, and we'll talk about the fact why we focus on a limited number of offices and a limited number of markets. And in 1997, you were too young to understand in 1997, but we're coming out of a major real estate collapse, and we made the evolution from a private partnership into a public company. And we'll talk a little bit about why we made that transition. We started off at $5.4 billion. Today, we're almost a $30 billion company. So you can see over the last 16 years, it's been very, very good for us. Unlike most real estate companies, which are almost anything for a buck type of mentality, we have had a philosophy relative to our business operations for the last 40 years. And number one is we focus on the best office markets and then the best submarkets within those markets. For instance, here in Washington, we're not in Tyson's Corner. Now, some of you may be with companies that are focusing on Tyson's. We're just not, okay, good to see you. We're not, sorry about that, our friend from Heinz. We're not wild about Tyson's, so we're not in that market. We're not wild about Silver Spring. So we focus not only, but we're very excited about Reston Town Center and other markets. So we focus on the best markets. That's why we're in 4 major markets. Boston, New York, San Francisco, and D.C., and then the best submarkets within those markets. We believe in value creation through development. That means we're not going out and just buying buildings at a 5 cap. We'd rather develop a building at 8, 9, or 10 cap. Obviously, aside from the better returns that you generate, you're getting brand new buildings. We bought buildings, and we'll talk about some of our acquisitions, where we get into the building and we find out that the preceding developer did not A, maintain it, or B, design and construct it consistent with our qualities and our objectives. We have bought strategic, irreplaceable assets that we couldn't otherwise develop, so we'll talk about that as well. We believe in designing, building, and operating to the highest of standards. We are committed to relationships, not only just with our investors, but with our tenants as well. We're a fairly experienced management team. I've been with Boston Properties for 34 years. I'd say the average age of the senior management, probably about 25 years with the company. And last but not least, I think what separates us from many other developers, specifically here in the Washington region, is a commitment to long-term ownership. There's a number of really wonderful competitors here, and I'm not here to blast them or say that their philosophy is not consistent with ours or not is better than ours. But there's some that that are in there, and they build it and they sell it virtually upon completion. Now, why would they do that? Anybody have an idea why they would sell immediately upon completion? It's called IRR. And so that means return on investment. They are funds that generate their profits by taking a cash investment from an investor and giving them maximum return. And so if they invest and they stabilize, and the stabilization is at 9 or 10%, and the IRR hurdle is like 15%, and the rents only go up at 3% a year, guess what? Their return is being diluted every year they hold the building. So you'll see a developer like JBG, who's one of our top competitors and very good, they will sell the buildings they're building up on H Street right now, the building where Walmart's going in, the apartment building, phenomenal project, did a great job. They're selling it before the tenant moves in, because that way their capital will be returned to their investors as quickly as possible with a maximum amount of return, and they get a greater promote. Our philosophy is we own for the long haul, we hardly ever sell, and we're generating annual returns to our investors as opposed to an IRR. Subtle difference that your professor is going to explain to you later. These are some of the assets that we own on a national basis. We call it our Monday Night Football assets, because if you're having a game in San Francisco, you'll see the Embarcadero lit up at night. If you saw the Red Sox unfortunately beat the Cardinals, you saw Go Sox on the Prudential Tower lit up in lights, Citigroup Center in New York. We're just trying to figure out how some of our assets could get on the Redskins game. Our buildings are too small here, so I'm not sure we'll get the Monday Night Football look here. This is some of our assets in DC, and I picked three or four different type of categories. The upper left on yours is one that we acquired in 1998, and one of your professors, Professor Morris, is here, was the key person with Boston Properties at that time that acquired that asset. That was one of those trophy assets. Now, I always give references relative to the bars in the city. This is where Old Ebbett is. That always seems to work well with college crowds. So this is the building where Old Ebbett is. This is an asset we bought for about $300 a square foot. We've held it now for 16 years. It's probably worth between $800 and $900 a foot. The building on the lower left is Thurgood Marshall Federal Judiciary. This is a building we built on a fee basis. And we don't have an ownership here. And the reason we build on a fee basis is that so we can keep our team employed. One of the things I'm most proud of in 34 years with Boston Properties is I never had to let a person go for lack of work. That even though times are difficult for development for our own account, we're out trying to get fee jobs that keep our team in place and engaged. The upper right is the first two buildings we built, Reston Town Center. We'll talk a little bit about Reston in a few minutes. And the last but not least, the one on the lower right, this is the building on Washington Circle. This is where District Commons and Circa is in Foggy Bottom. And we'll talk about this in a little greater detail, but one of the most successful buildings we have built. This is an overview of our portfolio. What's interesting is about 5 years ago, the portfolio was split evenly. About 3 million square feet downtown, 3 million in Maryland, and about 3 million in Virginia. Guess what? We decided to make a conscious move to move out of Maryland because we did not see the job growth and the rental rate growth in that area. In 1998, we made two major moves. We went to suburban Maryland. We bought two of the best suburban office parks, Greenfield, beautiful office parks. We bought Tower Oaks, where the Tower Oaks Clydes is. And we bought Washingtonian North, which is a 60-acre site right opposite the Washingtonian on 270. That very same point of time, we went out to Reston and came into Reston, and we bought into Reston Town Center. Only one building. In the intervening 16 years, we have developed two buildings in Maryland, both about 180,000 square feet, 360,000 square feet of density. Rental rates probably in the $33 to $35 square foot range. Occupancy about 85%. That same period of time, we went out to Reston. We have developed 3.5 million square feet, 10 times the amount of density in the same period of time. Rental rates that are in the mid to low 40s and a less than 1% vacancy out of 3.5 million square feet. And why would that happen? Why do you think those sites did so well versus the ones in Maryland? Any guesses? Mixed use. The mix of uses, the ability to create a live, work, play environment versus the greenfield suburban office parks. So back in the day when you used to drive up a mile road and it was had all this great trees and babbling brooks, you guys don't want that. How many of you live in the suburbs? Okay, the old guys, right? Okay. The young millenniums want to be here in the district. They want to have access to the amenity base. They want to be around other like-minded demographics. So we're getting out of the Greenfield Suburban Park and almost focusing exclusively on urban mixed use. These are some of our projects we just recently completed. Upper left is, again, the 2200 Penn building, one of our most successful projects. Lower left, another fee assignment. This was the headquarters we built for NPR, and we'll talk about how critical that was to our success lately. Upper right is a renovation where we had a major defense contractor move out through BRAC. We were very fortunate to land another 700,000 square foot tenant back into it, renovated it, and now it's 100% leased, fully renovated. And last but not least, an urban infill. We took an old building, 500 North Cap, at North Capitol and F Streets. These are some of the projects we have underway. The building across the street, which I'll talk about a little bit more. The Science and Engineering Hall for GW in the Foggy Bottom area. Lower left is the Avant. We're finding out that this multifamily gig is not a bad way to go. Because candidly, it's almost the exact opposite deal structure as an office building. An office building, we have a long-term lease with one or two, three tenants, and the income is pretty well fixed for better or for worse for 10 or 15 years. 10, 15 years go by, the tenant moves out, guess what? You have a completely vacant building with no chance to mark to market during that period of time. However, it does give you a solid cash flow you can finance against. So let's consider an apartment building. You got a chance, for better or for worse, to mark to market every single day of the year on the rents that roll over. A tenant moves out, we have the Avenue, which is dominated by young college people in that building, 335 units. Every year, about a third of those tenants move out, obviously since they graduate and move on. So we had to remark that mark to market, but it gives us a chance to do that. The other thing about an office building, if we have a major law firm in that office building, I have to have a personal relationship with that senior partner. Because if he ever moves out or she ever moves out, guess what? We have big problems. So when I see the phone ringing, it's DLA Piper, I'm answering that phone. Now, I've got a call from a young co-ed at the apartment building. I may want to have a personal relationship there, but I won't. But it's not important for me to have the relationship with the renter that's going to be there for 6 months to a year. So it's much more management intensive. That allows me to farm that property management relationship out to a third-party vendor, whereas an office building we're going to keep the entire time. The Signature site is another site where it's an infill in Reston Town Center. And last but not least, the Reston Gateway. How many people are familiar with the Reston Town Center? Well, that's great. Terrific. Thank you. We're going to get the opportunity to redevelop another Reston Town Center, which is most unusual. We bought a site there. Again, my good friend Professor Morris and I negotiated an acquisition of a portfolio, 1998. This was a throw-in. Okay, fast forward 15 years. Reston's killing it. Metro's coming to Reston. We're changing a 260,000 square foot, 30-year-old office building into 3.5 million square feet of vertical mixed use in the best market in the suburbs of the United States. So it's going to be a really good opportunity for us. So another question. In, as I mentioned, in 1997, we elected to go from a private partnership to a publicly traded REIT. What would be our motivation to do that? So think back about a private partnership. What are the attributes of a private partnership? Come on, guys, work with me here, okay? Private partnership, guess what? You have to go out and get your own equity every single time. And a private partnership, you have to go out and pledge the Volvo or your, you know, your pledge your assets to secure a construction loan. And remember in 1997, you were probably way too young to remember this, but certainly your professors and Bill and I remember, from the period of 1989, there's an expression, stay alive to 95. Things were so bad that private partnerships were going bankrupt almost on a daily basis. Well, we survived that fortunately because we got a little bit ahead of the game. We had that fee income I mentioned about developing buildings that would keep our staff in place. And we came to 1995 and said, you know what, we made it through. We're not going to do this again. So we looked at and explored a conversion into a REIT. And so let's talk about, first of all, the types of ownership that we could have explored. We have individual ownerships where each individual would own their own office building. That's very unusual now. Private partnerships, again, back in the early stages of development were the norm. That's when you can get 100% construction financing, and the need for capital, the need for equity is not as great. We, of course, have institutional ownership, Georgetown, GW, that would own buildings. We have foreign entities, and of course, back in the 80s, we had the Japanese influence. We had the English and Irish influence, Professor Joseph's here. But now we have more of the Middle East and some Chinese investment here, so foreign is very important. We have private REITs, and private REITs are where it's owned and in shareholders, but the shareholders can't change their stock. Okay, so you buy shares in a company that owns the real estate, but it's not liquid. Why anyone would want to own a private REIT? Are any people with private REITs here? Piedmont or any? No? No? Okay, good. Why anybody would want to do that? Because it doesn't give you the liquidity of a public REIT. We decided to become a public REIT. And why did we do that? We did that because when we established this private REIT that owns these buildings and developed them, there's no recourse against us personally. The REIT owns it. We don't have to pledge our assets. It is no risk to us as individual partners. We also have got multiple sources of capital. We've got the buy-in by the shareholders that create the equity. We've got direct debt, secured debt. We have unsecured debt. We have joint venture sources. There's any number of ways we can raise capital as opposed to using our own debt, our own capital. The other important thing is I was a private limited partner in our partnerships for 15 years. And even though I owned a piece of that building, being a limited as opposed to general, there was nothing I could do with it. It was completely illiquid. Any decision regarding my 5% ownership was dictated by the general partners. So it was not the best situation for us. When we rolled that into a REIT, and we took a building that was worth $100 million, and I owned a small piece of that, my small piece would then become shares in Boston Properties, Inc., that I have full discretion and flexibility to decide the investment decisions for that. So for those of us that were individual limited partners, it was a great situation. We're also able to give all of our employees ownership in the asset that we develop as Boston Properties, okay? So if we had a construction manager, we didn't want to dilute the private partnership by giving him ownership or her ownership, but now we can give them shares of stock. So every person is, quote, an owner at Boston Properties. The units are shares. It's a little complicated here. Your professors will explain this. It's called an operating partnership unit. And we're able to go out and buy buildings like Met Square or that building I mentioned in Reston from a owner of the real estate. And you know what a 1031 is, where you exchange like-kind interest in real estate to defer the capital gains? They were able to take Boston Properties units in the same exchange vehicle as you would have if we exchanged it for office like-kind real estate. So it allowed us to free up some of the really hidden assets. You will see the Embarcadero Center, which we bought from the Rockefeller family. They did it with Boston Properties because they liked our currency, our stock. Metropolitan Square, we did that with Ollie Carr. He liked our stock. It freed up assets that would otherwise not be able to be available to us by using our units. And because we're now so big, and we're not taking the personal risk as a REIT, we're able to take on much more risk than otherwise would. The project that you see in Washington Circle, the Avenue is what you call it, which is 335 apartment buildings, 440,000 square feet of office space, and about 80,000 square feet of retail. It was a $400 million project. We built it for cash. We didn't have to get a loan. It was 2008. It was very tough. It was a ground lease. We were being sued. And so any other organization in the real estate arena, unable to get a construction loan, in the worst times in the world, would not be able to build that, but we were able to proceed. But it's not all upside. There's some negative access for us going public. First of all, full disclosure of information. For better or for worse, you can go online, Google, and you can find out exactly what I made last year. That doesn't help when you're negotiating allowances with your children, I will tell you, when they see that. So that sometimes that full exposure, the full disclosure of our activities is sometimes troublesome. There's also a disconnect between the value of our assets, market conditions, and share price. If another developer in our sector goes BK, if there is sequestration, which hurts the DC office market, our share stock goes down or goes up, independent of the underlying value of the real estate. So that is a little bit of a tweak that we get, and it's very frustrating. Where we're doing a great job, we're 98% leased in Washington D.C., and the stock went down, $3 a share. The other thing is related to that is we have big peaks and valleys. So we went public in 1997 at $25 a share. Fast forward to 2006, we're at 135. Wow, pretty cool, right? 2008 comes along. Our share price goes down to $25 a share again. So I come home to my wife of 40 years. I say, and I got really bad news. The stock's at $25 a share. Our options are wiped out. Our net worth is a fraction of what it was, 2 years ago. She says to me, Ray, the stock could go to zero. I'd still love you. I'd miss you, but I'd still... True story, but I still love you. The other thing is the individual performance is unrelated to the performance of the stock. I could do a deal like the Square 54, absolutely kill it, and yet there was not going to be the individual performance related to that performance of that asset. We're also, our decisions, we have to go back to Boston and New York to get our decisions approved by a board of directors, independent, to validate that we're doing the right thing. And last, and probably the most frustrating, with all due respect to you in the room, okay, is that next week I fly to San Francisco with the senior management team of Boston Properties. They lock me in a room for about 2.5 days. Every hour on the hour from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m., a group of individuals just about the same demographic and the same experience as people in this room come in and ask me what we're doing to advance the shareholder stock. And it's certainly their right. They've invested in Boston Properties, but it's somewhat frustrating to kind of go repeat every hour, why is not space leasing, and what's the market conditions, what's the impact of sequestration, and having that third-party scrutiny on how we go about doing things is a little bit of a challenge. This is our capital stack today. You can see that we have the stock and OP units is shareholder value. Their investment in Boston Properties is about $18.5 billion. We have about $1.6 billion in cash. So if something comes across our doorstep that requires immediate action, a site we like, a building we want to buy, a company we want to acquire, we have the cash reserves on hand to act immediately and to close the deal. Secured debt is the debt we have on a specific building. So this is like a traditional mortgage that you would have in your house. This is what we have secured directly to that specific asset. We like to keep our buildings that have secured debt to the maximum amount possible. Why would that be? Because that frees up a unsecured group of buildings that we can do the next thing, which is unsecured debt. So we then allows us to sell buildings that are unsecured. We don't have to worry about yield maintenance. We're able to sell those buildings without having to go through the whole imagination of getting rid of secured debt. So if we're going to put a mortgage on a piece of property, we're going to do that to the absolute maximum we possibly can. So we have a total market cap of $29 billion, and about a third of that is debt. So you can see that we're well capitalized. This is what people look for in a public company. People are looking for REITs pretty much for income. They don't want to wake up one day and find out that the income has gone away. So we're not about yield like a JBG that's going to be turning you a 15 or 18% IRR. People are buying us for a 2 to 3 to 4% dividend and stock growth between 5 and 10% a year. Now, fortunately, we really outperformed that. Since IPO, we've returned 776% on the initial dollar invested. Pretty good. This shows you the stock performance of Boston Properties relative to all other REITs and to the S&P 500. You see that nosedive right there about 2008? That's when my wife told me how much she loved me. Okay, so that gives you some sense of the fluctuations. Now, do you honestly believe that the value of our assets went down 80%? Of course not. This is where that stock was brought about by impacts well beyond that of the performance of the stock. So, first of all, do you all have any questions? You're not helping me out here. So I want you to come on, let's participate. So think of things. Yes, sir.
Having your decisions run by the board as opposed to not, did you feel as though that was slowing you down in the initial stages of the IPO?
That's a good question. Is that the question is, what impact has had the board had on our decision-making ability? Fortunately for Boston Properties, our chairman, Mr. Zuckerman, handpicked every board member. So fortunately, and given the level of success we've had over the last 15 or 16 years, we have not been hamstrung. There is tremendous pressure on behalf of the corporate governance community to make as many of the board's independent board members as independent as possible. But still, we have not had any problems slowing down our decision-making ability. Any other questions? Quick? Yes, sir. Our decision to list the avenue for sale?
Yes, sir. We're trying to use the microphone because this is being recorded.
I'll repeat the question.
Okay.
And make it a little easier. So the question was, we have decided to sell the apartment element of the avenue, that mixed-use project of Washington Circle. And it's a great question because it's a wonderful asset. But there's a couple things going on there. And I'm in the area of full disclosure, right? What stays in this room, says in the room, stays in this room. It is a, first of all, it's a relatively short-term ground lease. It was a 60-year ground lease. We're down to 55. Well, people ask, why did you do a ground lease? Well, that's the only way we could get it is GW insisted upon doing a ground lease of 60 years. And we have an expression in Boston Properties, part of something's better than all or nothing. That's such a great piece of real estate, we'd rather own it for 60 years than not at all. So we have a ground lease that is going to be proceeding towards the expiration of its term. It is also a tremendous cash flowing machine. Kate's a resident there. Thank you, Kate, for making that happen for us. And it is just cranking. And cap rates today for that will be in the 4.5% to 5% range because the 10-year treasuries is 2.6. We're believing that there's greater downside to rising interest rates than upside to declining interest rates. And there is a point at which they could only push rents. We're averaging $4.50 per square foot for those apartments. To put it in perspective, you can go up at Denoma and lease units for about $2.10. The other thing too is with this specific asset, the great news is that we have unlimited amount of demand from the GW students. The bad news is GW students roll out with greater frequency than a traditional residential tenant. So we're constantly churning that asset. So we've elected to sell, take it to the market. Hopefully we'll get the right price. I'll report back next year on how it goes. But we're cautiously optimistic that we're going to do okay. So if you explored my bio, yes, Bill.
Risk assessment?
You know, our risk assessment is based on 34 years of doing it here. We do not, there's no amount of comfort you can get from a third party report. Julian, what was the name of the company you used to do? Leventhal, what's the group that used to do the hotel reports? Leventhal. Yeah, we used to go out and get a Leventhal report on a hotel. Well, you know, that was so analytical and didn't really get your gut. And we still, after 34 years of doing it with Boston Properties, go by our gut. And we knew the original deal structure was a joint venture between Boston Properties and the office building and another local developer who shall remain nameless on the apartment building. So we entered, we compete for the rights to do the development deal. We win GW. We like to think that we won it because we had a great team. We like to think we won because we had this great design. I know we won because we bid this outrageous price. We bid the high price. We were very comfortable about where we were in the office building. But we had a residential partner that really thought this was going to be terrific. And so he built a big price. We go through a three-year entitlement process. The end of 3 years, we get the entitlement. 2008, remember, no money available. We go to the closing table. The night before, my partner calls me up and says, not going to be there tomorrow. And so that led us to be the developers of our first multifamily building. Because I had already pre-leased 50% of that office building. We couldn't get the CEO of the office building until we built the apartment building. So I had to go to our board on a ground lease, first apartment building, and by the way, Foggy Bottom, the People's Republic of Foggy Bottom, came to us and said, we're suing you because we don't think your entitlements are correct. And yet we were able to convince the board that this was the right thing to do. So sometimes going contrary, being a contrarian, building when you think things are absolutely the worst, guess what? Results. You ever see the Forrest Gump movie? Where they take the ship out in the storm, they haul that shrimp in, and they make a gazillion dollars? That was us in 2008. We persevered and built an apartment building and an office building when the market did not justify it. So we went ahead, we built it, and the risk was great. But again, getting back to a public company, we had the cash resources and the lack of exposure that allowed us to go forward. So many of you are making career decisions relative to real estate. How many of you guys want to be developers? Okay. How many want to be brokers? Okay. We're going to talk about that. Because I started off as a broker, spent 3 years at Coldwell Banker back in the day when Coldwell Banker was brand new to the area. Made a lot of money, and then ran into Mr. Zuckerman. I brought three tenants to his building, his first building in Washington, and said, we want to hire you. And I said, no, I'm doing well. And long story short, after a nine-month negotiation, and those of you who know Mr. Zuckerman's reputation knows a rather intense negotiation, I joined Boston Properties. And believe me, it's been a great run for me at Boston Properties. But let's talk today about the comparison as you consider career paths between brokerage and the development side. There's an historical belief that the natural progression for brokerage is to be a developer, and that usually was the case. And in the 1970s and 80s, there was almost a monopoly by developers and really price collusion that kept brokerage commissions down. And you know, as a developer back then, as I talked about as a private partnership, you would get major capital events on a sale or refinance, and you had this feeling that you're masters of the universe and building buildings that fed our male ego, now both male and female egos, and you had the decision-making criteria for whether you hire or fire architects, general contractors, and you were able to accumulate wealth on a tax-deferred basis, so it was quite attractive. The roles are reversed now. You know, first of all, we can't do a deal until we have a lease. We can't do a lease without the help of a broker. So the broker now has almost emerged to the top of the food chain. And the dilution of our equity, not so much with, well, my equity is only my shares. I'm a salaried employee of Boston Properties right now. I'm not a partner. I don't get, as I said, I don't get a piece of the deal. I'm a salaried employee with option. And so it really creates almost a flip side now where the broker generates more proceeds than the developer. The other thing, if I'm stuck in a project that's not going anywhere, I'm stuck with that project. I'm cranking, I'm trying to get that thing started. If you're a broker with a project that's not leasing, guess what? You pick off and move to one that is. So it gives you much more greater flexibility in terms of your career path. We are salaried employees. Also, the gestation period, how long it takes for a development deal. We started the Avenue in 2004. 9 years later, it's now stabilized. And we're finally seeing the benefits of our involvement. With the increased competition for tenants in this marketplace, guess what? Developers are throwing more and more money towards the brokers to make the deals happen. The commissions are the first dollars out, not the last, like on the development side. And you know the long-term appreciation of assets, we've seen assets kind of come and go now. And some assets that we you know, we see assets that were traded for 500 a foot and now worth 300 a foot. So you can't bank on long-term appreciation. I think one of the best examples is I give my son David Ritchey. Dave graduated from college, 1999, probably well before many of you in the room, but he went to college. Because of exposure to real estate, he said, Dad, I want to go into real estate. I said, that's great, Dave, but you're not going to do it here. I want you to go someplace else where you're your own man, your own person, develop your own skill set. So he goes to San Francisco and becomes a broker there, kills it, does really well, meets his wife, decides that he wants to go back into the East Coast, goes to MIT, the one-year program there, almost as good as Georgetown. And by the way, I would tell you, your Georgetown group last year on the MIT real estate set killed it. Three part-time people made the full-time people from everywhere else look silly. They did a great job, so he should be very proud. So he finishes MIT. What do you think he wants to do? He wants to become a developer, right? So he goes to work for a great development company here in Washington, D.C., gets assigned a couple projects, 2005, 2006, 2007, 2008. Project's going nowhere. He says, Dad, I want to go back into brokerage. So fast forward 4 years now, he's one of the top brokers in town, working with some of the best developers, representing some of the best tenants, tremendous flexibility, and really enjoyed himself. So when you consider your career options, please consider not what you think is going to be the sexiest or the most important in the food chain, there, whether it's property management, finance, brokerage, there's many career options. And the mere fact that I'm sitting here in front of 80 very talented, very smart, very energetic, hardworking people, that all we will be competing for the same five development jobs, it may be worthwhile for you to consider other options other than straight up development. I'm just throwing this out for your consideration. Yes, Barbara.
So let's come back to the male egos comment.
Yes, male egos. That's a very good question. The question is, how do we convert the traditionally male, you're talking of the development side.
Real estate in general.
Well, I would take exception to that, Barbara, because I will tell you that we're seeing, and this gets back to the brokerage. If I was to list to you the top 10 brokers, specifically as relates to tenant representation in the District of Columbia, at least five would be female. So I think this is also what I'm trying to highlight here is that there's that. The big reason why, lack of capital. The banks, the investors are still not equipped to, and track record. People are not giving $100 million to a person, this is their first project. So it's almost like a vicious circle. I will tell you though, fortunately, quite fortunately, the cycle is changing. We lost a tremendously talented project manager, African-American female, that was terrific. Her husband was in the administration, went back to take a job with Disney. She went back with him. I almost offered her husband a job to keep her here. That's how much we wanted to keep her. Not only she was talented, but when I go into a room and I'm pitching a law firm, and by the way, the legal profession is now, Barbara, dominated by, at least 50-50 in terms of the people coming out of law school.
Coming out of law school, yes.
Which bodes for the future. They're helping make a decision.
One would hope. It's been 50-50 for 15 or 20 years.
Well, we're getting there. Okay. But if a 63-year-old white guy shows up, okay, me, and there's a panel of a diverse panel We need to have representation. It's not only the right thing from a presentation standpoint, it's the right thing to do culturally and for our society and for our company. So we're looking for diversity, and we would love to partner with. We have some great female developers here. Debbie Salzberg comes to mind with Four Cities. Pam Bundy on the minority side, terrific. So we're encouraging females to come on. We specifically go out, and if there's a jump ball between a male or female, sorry guys, we're going for the diversity factor on that. So when you look at your career path, I want you to really think about all your options. Because you're going to come up to me tonight and say, listen, great, I'm really excited about going into development. I would tell you the best thing to do is learn how to do a lease, create value through the lease process, demonstrate to us that you can go out and bring tenants to the building. That's how you create value in an organization, is generate the income and the opportunities. We have a standing order when a broker comes to us and says, how can we get your business on this building? We say to them, one way you can guarantee that you get our business is bring us the opportunity. If you bring us an opportunity to buy an existing building, or bring us a killer site, and we go forward with the development, if you have the capacity to be the leasing agent on that, we'll give you the leasing agent. If you have the capacity to sell it, we'll give you the listing to sell it. So again, I can't come here today and give you this pep talk about how great it is to be a real estate development company like Boston Properties without either A, pointing out the downside, and B, exposing you to the other options that are out there. Any other questions, comments? Yes, sir.
Yes. In your career path, I read your bio and I saw that you served in the Navy.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a veteran as well. I was just wondering, could you speak on how your transition was going from the military to the civilian?
Okay. The question was how I transitioned from the military into the real estate market. You have to remember, of course, this is 1976. How many were alive in 76? Okay, not many of you. Okay. 1976, I graduated from Annapolis, fortunate enough to go to graduate school, was at the Pentagon getting out, 26 years old, wife and two kids. Wife and two kids, 26 years old. Scary, isn't it? Been with the same person for 45 years. I'm a person of long-term relationships. So we're getting out. And I was offered a job in Allentown, Pennsylvania. How many of you seen The Office? It's like going to work for Dunder Mifflin. I was going to go to work for Dunder Mifflin. And I said, you know, I bought a townhouse at 26-year-old in Burke, commuted in by bus. I said, I really don't want to leave D.C. I think D.C. is the best place for me. And so this is really important. One takeaway that you can take from the night that will give you some really good experience. Don't send an email, don't send a letter when you're doing something important. Hand carry whatever it is to the person you want to get his attention. So I took a day off from the Pentagon, I drove out to Annapolis, I went to the alumni director and said, here's my resume. If somebody's looking for a Naval Academy graduate, have them give me a call. So the very next day, the guy from Coldwell Banker, which is now CBRE, came out to Annapolis and said, we're from Coldwell Banker, we're opening up our first East Coast office. We've had great success hiring Academy graduates on the West Coast. Do you know anybody who may be interested in going to real estate? And I'm sure the director reached in the trash can, and because the trash can wasn't emptied yet, okay, handed to Jim O'Brien, and he gave me a call. And I walked in that office. I knew the minute that I walked in that office that that's what I wanted to do. Okay, so Jim offers me $900 a month to start. I had a $600 a month house payment. Two babies, wife didn't work, my father just passed away. Yet I took the job. And so the other lesson is, at this point in time in life where you have virtually no personal overhead, if you're going to take risk to do something, do it. And so, long story short, I struggled for the first year. I then became a fairly successful broker, stumbled into Mort Zuckerman, and I joined Boston Properties. So my two takeaways from as a piece of advice to you is don't rely on email, don't rely on the U.S. Postal Service, for God's sake. Make the personal connection with the people that you want to make the connection with, the future. And you're at the point in the time in your life where to take some risk. Shoot for the moon, give some, you don't have the overhead, let's make it happen. Because I see too many people say, well, geez, you know, I'm not sure I can make it as a broker, I'm not sure that I can take that personal overhead on. I mean, I have too much personal overhead. This is the point in time in life where you have the least amount of personal overhead, so you can take the greatest amount of risk. So again, just to give some thought on these various decision points as you go through your career path, I also like to extend to you, this is big, okay? Any point in time you have a question or comment, give me a call. Don't all do it the same day, okay? Because I do have a day job, okay? But if I could be of some help to you through your career path, and some of you in this office, this auditorium I've already talked to, because I really believe so many people helped me along the way, I'd really like to be helpful to you all as well. So if you have questions or comments about points in time in your career, I'd love to address that. Okay, so as the bottom line to that, is there a shift in the dynamics between brokers and developers? And I'm just asking you to consider brokerage and other aspects towards a career in real estate. You know, if you ask anybody in real estate, the two individuals who have made the most amount of money in real estate over the last 2 years, any guesses? Andy Florence of CoStar and Mark Bisno of Bisno. Not Boston Properties, not Ray Ritchey. They have created value on real estate related services. So my suggestion to you is also think outside the box. Things that are maybe related to your passion in real estate. And after you make your money in something on the tech side, then go out and develop a spec building. But just keep your options open in all areas. Any other questions before we go on? How are we doing time-wise, Bill? Were we, am I good? Okay.
The more you talk, the better.
Okay, great. So the next question is, I noticed the Boston property sign on the site directly across the street. Could you give us a quick overview of what must be a most exciting project? So if you came in this building, you saw a hole in the ground across the street, and that is, in fact, a Boston Properties building. And hopefully 2 years from now, this is what the building will look like. It's designed by Duda Payne out of North Carolina. It's a 440,000 square foot office building. It's a really interesting site in that it's triangular in nature. Now, why would a triangle be a good shape for an office building, especially in today's market? Yes, sir.
Floor plan.
It has, you never see anything shipped in a triangular box, right? Because it has less interior relative to the perimeter. That's the exact opposite of what you want in an office building. You want less interior area and the greatest amount of perimeter. So when we bought this site 6 years ago, in what candidly was kind of viewed as a little bit of edgy location, and by the way, Bill, I want to congratulate Georgetown on picking this location, because it's great for a public transportation, it's great for amenity base, it's where many of you live. And we couldn't be happier to have you across the street from our building. So this will be an 11-story, 440,000 square foot building. We bought the site in 2008, and again, remember back to 2008, why would you buy a site in 2008? Because we entered into a 5-year lease back with the owner of the building, NPR. So we gave them a big price, but they leased it back to us at 5.5%, escalated for 5 years. So the entire 5-year period that we are planning this site and pre-leasing it and getting it ready to start, we had absolutely no carry. In fact, we had positive cash flow. So it worked out really well for us. Additionally, it allowed us in a time of very challenging times in the real estate business to build their new headquarters on a fee basis. So we kept 3 or 4 people busy, generated profits, great carry on the site. And not only that, we also got great, now when we go out and pitch a tech tenant now, we can take them out to NPR and show them some really cool tech space. So it's a 460,000 square foot office building. It'll be delivered about 2 years from now. And of course, it's going to be LEED Gold. Why did we get this site? This map should tell it all. It shows all the new development, all the new amenity base. This is a 24/7 environment close to where the young workforce wants to live. And this is what convinced our lead tenant Arlen Porter to move off Pennsylvania Avenue up to this area. And if you see the transition, the migration, Covington's up here, Georgetown's up here, we're really feeling good about this dynamic in terms of meeting the needs of where people want to be. These are the new projects coming up surrounding our project. Again, another view of the front. We're putting this atrium. The building is so shallow that, you know, a lot of buildings have atriums. We had to put our atrium on the perimeter because we had so little interior area and really created a really wonderful entry point into the building. This is our lobby, again, exposed to right across the street from your building. And this shows the atrium. And this shows the stacking plan for Arnold and Porter. So Arnold and Porter comes to us and says, listen, we're taking 75% of the building. We want to take all the top floors all the way across. And we said, no can do. Why would we not want to do that? Because it would leave us nothing but the lower floors, the least attractive space to lease. So what we did was we stacked them across the top, the first four or five floors, and then down the east side, leaving us the point overlooking the park for our spec space, which has a tremendous amount of perimeter, phenomenal views, because most developers will tell you that you have to be exceedingly careful about encumbering space, the growth space for that lead tenant. Because if you give up too much space and you give the encumbered space in areas that you cannot lease, the building will not be profitable. The profit of the building is not in the first 80%, it's in the last 20%. So you have to make sure that building is leasable. So you can see we kept that green space overlooking the courtyard, the park across the street. This is the floor plate. Look at the amount of perimeter offices we have relative to the interior zone. And we even notched that corner there. You see, we took the apothecary of the triangle out. You see that little notch there? So rather than keep it parallel across and create a very difficult condition on the inside of the floor plate, we notched it. So it really breaks into a 25,000 square foot floor plate on one side with a core and a 20,000 square foot floor plate on the west side with a core. And the spec space is on the west side, and you see that it's all perimeter office space. Because law firms today, the evolution of law firms with no file storage, no law libraries, no on-site, files, a material reduction in the ratio of secretarial support. And if you're going out and recruit a young lawyer today, she doesn't want to be in an interior office. She wants to be on the perimeter. So we maximize the amount of perimeter space. So you can see why this would be attractive to a law firm going forward. This is the view out of the spec space, overlooking the park. So we see we position this building to maximize the profitability, not only the space for Arnold and Porter, but for the spec space going forward. Any questions about that? I also want to point out that you see that little retail space there? There's a show, Bill and Juliana, they have this really wonderful restaurant in Chicago called RPM on the Food Network. They just picked that to put their DC facility across the street from you guys. So 2 years from now, that's going to be one of the really hot new restaurants in town. We're really excited about having that. The retail should do really well here, so a little bit of scoop. Any other questions about the building? Yes, Barbara.
You planning on moving your management offices there?
The question is whether we're moving our management office, Boston Properties offices over there. We're big believers in the East End. In fact, we have got four buildings within three blocks of this location, and we've been on the East End for a long time. And we moved over to 2200 Penn, the building on the circle. I will tell you, this is a challenge that we're facing in this marketplace because it's a dynamic that every law firm debates because the more senior partners, and I clearly would qualify as a senior partner, tend to live in Northwest Washington,